Are you tired of the rat race in America? Are you ready to visit the motherland to relax and rejuvenate? Are you ready to explore all that Africa has to offer? Then check out the brand new Diversified Game Academy course, Prepare for My First Trip to Africa. Are you worried about being able to afford the trip? We got you. We will show you how to travel either on a budget or as a baller. Learn how to stress the value of the USD. Did you know that 100 United States dollars is worth over 1,000 South African rand, or 10,000 Kenyan shillings, or 54,250 West African CFA? Are you worried about taking your kids? Get the game from Kellen Cash, a bona fide world traveler, having traveled to almost 20 countries, several of those in Africa. Get the game on taking your kids on their first trips. Learn how to find the best tickets, get the visas, and plan your own adventures in Africa. Don't let Eddie Murphy have all the fun. Plan your own coming to Africa trip, starring you, produced by you, and featuring you. If you are ready for a life-changing experience, sign up for our course today, Diversified Game Academy. Get prepared and purchase at diversifiedgame.com.
I'm Dr. Dillard, I'm CEO of Institute of Progressive Sustainable Development. Our offices are located in Seattle, Washington, and Atlanta, Georgia.
Hey, it's Kellen, and today on Diversified Game, this is going to be it's my favorite topic to talk about. Africa and the progress, and those who are pushing Africa to the next limits, who want to invest. I have Dr. Dillard. Now, that's medical Dr. Dillard for y'all, and he's also pilot Captain Dillard, and all the other things that he can do. He can ride horses, but he is representing right now his institution for progressive, sustainable development. And I got word of it from my friend who looks like he could have been in the Matrix. And he said, I'm going to Africa, Kelly. You'll be proud of me. And he said, Dr. Dillard was the reason. So, Dr. Dillard, how are you doing today?
I'm good, Kelly. What about you?
All is good. All is blessed, man. I'm blacktastic, as many like to say. And I just want you to let the people know, what is IPSD all about?
IPSD is Institute for Progressive Sustainable Development. And it was created from an idea that we wanted to, I'm a doctor, medical doctor. I travel all around the world and I worked in a lot of different clinics. And a lot of us, sometimes we become doctors because we want money. Then we get to a certain age that we just want to do something for humanity. So I wanted to pick a pet project, that a legacy project, I'd call it, where I wanted to see what kind of effect I could have in Africa. And so we decided with the IPSD thing was progressive sustainable development, because we see a lot of sustainable development projects in the African continent. And people go in, they drill a well, or they do some humanitarian aid, and it doesn't really affect the majority of the people in those countries. So I wanted to be progressive sustainable development, which would be development where we go in, when we actually create projects that would have a big impact on the citizens in a country. So our projects are more like infrastructure projects, big, massive projects, dams, power, manufacturing, seafood, plants. Those are things where we create employment in the different nations, as well as help to create a middle class. We felt that Africa didn't have a middle class. It had a rich class and then it had a poor class. And the, because in Africa, you have the leaders of the country, they create partnerships with corporations from the West, whether European or American. So they go in and create these corporations and they become partners in the corporations and board members, and then they receive stock shares from their corporation. And so they actually reap all the benefits. And the reason why they do it is because you don't have to worry about the people voting for you like we do here in America. You know, if I pay my taxes and you don't do what I want, then we can do recalls on you and take the position away. In Africa, you can't do that. So you just have to wait till the next election come around. But if I'm poor and I'm just basically living on basic subsistence, and election comes around, I don't care who's voting. If anybody offered me $10, they can have my vote. And that's how it's done in most of the countries, some of the countries in Africa. I'm not saying in all of them. So if we create a middle class, then the middle class would have a vote, and then they could hold the leaderships accountable. And a lot of like hospitals, roads, and bridges and infrastructure that countries really need in order to sustain a middle class, and governments will be compelled to do that because they have a middle class. So that's why we chose to do the larger projects. And those projects are supported by the US governmental agencies like State Department, the Department of Commerce, the United Nations, and we utilize private funding, and we also utilize public funding from institutions like the NGO.
So let me ask you this, because, you know, we've talked offline, and you are just like interesting all the way. How did you know you could do this? Because you've gone to law school, you've gone to medical school, you've gone to Dartmouth. I mean, what can't you do? Who are you? Somebody would say, what superhero are you? And what do you have to prove? And saying, let me go to Africa to do this, because I've done everything else. You know, I've flown planes, I rode horses. Like, what drives you to do all of these things?
Well, you know, I met quite a few people in different professions that says, like, you don't know what you want to be when you grow up. And so I bore really easy, you know. I'm Mensa, bore easily. And if something doesn't hold my attention long enough, then I move on to the next thing, which is a good, bad thing, and it can also could be a good thing. I understand how government works, right? I've been an attorney. You learn how government works. And when you're traveling around the world and you think about the things that you learned about government and how it works and how it's affecting different places that you visited, then you can sort of put it all together and you realize there's only a top level of government, top level of what we call quote unquote world order. And when you understand how that top level works, then you are able to figure out how the things that you have learned along the way, how it might could enhance that top level status of government leaders. So we know that government gets, developing nations get government from the IMF and the United Nations, the US government, and some of the European governments like France and Great Britain and the Norwegian countries all put money into sustainable development or development in developing nations. Specifically, the one we're talking about today is Africa. I mean, it's the continent is Africa, there's 54 nations there. And so then once you understand that what's really going on in geopolitical, is that because of the natural resources that they take away from the country, that what they put back into the country is sort of guilt money. And it makes the corporations feel that they are making a contribution for what they've taken out, even though their contribution is substantially lower than what they're taking out. Then you come in and then you say, well, I want to make this better. And how can I make it better? And I think one of the biggest problems in the geopolitical sphere with companies trying to create development opportunities in Africa is they look at the whole continent of Africa. which is 104 billion people. And when you look at the world itself, it's just not enough money. If we put all of the economies together, the biggest economy is the U.S. economy of $23 trillion. So we put all those world's economies together, it's not enough money to go in and uplift 54 countries. So then we looked at how they did in Europe, excuse me, when the United States blew up Europe, blew Europe into smithereens after World War II, and then they decided they wanted to go back and rebuild it. At that time, at the end of the war, they destroyed 5 million apartments and homes, and they had 12 million refugees. And so they came up with the Marshall Plan. And what the Marshall Plan did was it looked at the countries individually. They created a plan to support them, and they created a fund. And they created a fund so that they could help the business community have a resurgence in Europe. The United States was going to do all the manufacturing like it's China doing today. The U.S. was going to do all the manufacturing. Then the European companies would do all the buying of the products. European companies didn't have any capital. So the U.S. created a fund, made loans of dollars to the European nations. And then they instituted a business exchange program where they took the Europeans and brought them to American corporations, taught them American business principles and policies. They went back to Europe with what they call special envoys. And those envoys, they were from American corporations, and they just would be there for 2 or 3 years to help the European businesses implement those principles they had learned in the U.S. So we looked at that, and we looked at, okay, so this is how Europe, the resurgence of Europe after it had been blown to smithereens. Then we looked at what they did in Asia. They did the same thing in Asia with the Japanese car auto manufacturer. Those plants were, and I think a lot of them still have American shareholders, that some of the Japanese, like Mazda, Toyota. But they brought the Japanese over to the United States, taught them how to build cars. The Japanese went back to Japan, and then the American companies built the factories. They had like what they call build, own, and then transfer, what they call bot. So they built those plants. Then the United States companies held them for so many years before they turned them over to the Japanese industry. Did the same thing in China. Did the same thing with airplanes, Boeing Airplane Company. They went over and they established and taught the Chinese factories how to build airplane parts. And so we see that these models have been created all around the world, but they were never created in Africa. And so because Africa is such a large continent, we decided that we need to do it one country at a time. And so it's an experimental project. So we decided that we would pick one of the smaller countries in Africa, which was Sierra Leone, because it has 7 million people. And by creating it in a small company, and then you're gonna refine your model. And you work on your model, you refine the model, and then once you perfect that model, you take that model, and then you can move it out into other countries to help those countries to develop. So this was the impetus and the thought process of the Institute for Progressive Sustainable Development. We just took a little bit from different things that we've seen happen throughout history in development and try to institute that into one model to take into Africa.
Well, with all the accomplishments that you have, what's the driving, the force? Is it that, some people say, oh, I'm doing it for my kids, I'm doing it for my wife, I'm doing it for my grandkids. Like, what makes you say, okay, I want to do all these things? Because to even get into law, to go to law school, become a lawyer, and to possibly help people, but then to go into medicine to help people, and now to go to Africa, what's that push that says, I have to do this? Because you could easily just, be vacationing around the world like we see many Instagram influencers do. What pushes you?
Well, when I was growing up, and it was eight of us, and I was the ninth sibling. In my household, my father wouldn't allow us to say the word can't. If I said I can't do something, the first thing to come out of his mouth is no such thing as can't. And so even up to today, when I want to do something, it's like I still hear his voice saying, I can't say, I can't do it. And then I had a sister who passed away, but she had a great influence on me. And I remember when she was in the hospital bed, she always wanted to be a model, but she never went after it. And when she was passing away on the hospital bed, she made me promise her that I would never say, I wish I could have been, or I should have been this, I should have been that. And so I think those things drove me to reach for heights and to excel. And then the desire that I didn't want to be ignorant of a lot of things that I had interest in. Like with law, you know, I was interested in law because I came up in the civil rights movement. So I was interested in law because I felt you need to know law. I felt, and it was kind of looking for absolutes. When I went to law school, I studied law, and my interest was constitutional law. Then I turned into business law. And then I decided I want to work for the United Nations. And then a couple of cases that we studied where just told me that there was no absolutes for law. Law is the experience of the interpreter. That's how you interpret the law, is from your experiences. And so you can have two people who come from two different experiences, they're going to interpret the same sentence in law differently. And so there was no absolutes there. And I ended up working for a company in Seattle, Perkins & Coie. It was the largest law firm on the West Coast at the time with 450 lawyers. And we were on three continents, Europe, Asia, and the United States, with offices in the US and Seattle, San Francisco, and New York City. And I worked in business law first, and then I ended up in family law and saw how it's all a business. It's all a business. And like we do pro bono services for people who did not have funding for an attorney. And those cases had to be open and shut immediately. But when we did cases for the really wealthy clients, we wouldn't allow to close the cases because they might have been worth $30 million. And their senior partners felt that they could take them for $2 or $3 million out of their $30 million. So you couldn't close those cases. You had to keep those cases open. So I had trouble going to sleep at night, taking advantage of people, whether they were rich or poor. And poor people, cases were closed. They shouldn't have been closed. And rich people's cases was open. They shouldn't have been open. They should have been closed earlier. And so I just felt that I was part of a part of a money scheme. And I mean, I like money, and I'm driven like to have money like everybody else is, but I don't want to take advantage of people for money. And so I worked in law for about 3.5 years. And then I went into engineering, and I did my own engineering firm. But those were the things that kind of drove me and the thing to help others. You know, I felt I've been blessed in my life, I think, and pretty much had everything I ever wanted to have that man could make. And I found no satisfaction in any of it. And I just thought that my satisfaction, I always tell people all the time, if I help an old lady get off a bus, the bus stopped and she's trying to get off the bus. If I help her off that bus, and then somebody offered me $1 million, I'll take $1 million, but I get more satisfaction off of helping that old lady off the bus. That's what helps me sleep at night. So I guess the answer to your question is I'm just driven to help others. And I always have been, and I find satisfaction in it.
Wow, that's a great, you know, just I love to hear the story, because with social media, we always see great, hey, I retired at 25 and I retired my mother, but folks are working hard every day so somebody can buy something from them, but they've retired, right? Whatever retirement looks like. But you have proven yourself, not just in business, but in academics and even in your works with this project of bringing people who've never even been to Africa and getting them there. What can people do, that everyday person who got their, you know, stimulus check, whatever that amount was, and says, I want to go to Africa. I want to learn. I want to be a part of this. I don't have, you know, $50,000 to my name. Heck, I barely have $5,000, right? Or $500. What can they do inside of your program that can not just benefit their life, but the whole organization as a whole?
Well, you know, we realize that, you know, in our country, most African-Americans doesn't have, it could cost, to go to Africa, spend a week or 2 weeks there, it's going to cost you $5,000 or $10,000. Most African-Americans, the average African-American's got about $71 in their savings account versus the dominant white culture that has average of $370,000 in their savings accounts. So we can't really take those type of vacations or those types of trips unless we save up forever. And then we have other expenses that we got to, that we incur, just home, just living expenses and gas and lunch at work and going to work, childcare, that we probably would never really even get a trip like that. A lot of us take trips into the Caribbean and you can get round trip tickets there for about $350. When you're going to Africa, your round trip ticket is going to cost you at a minimum about $2,500. So we realized that. And then we realized that in our program, in order to accomplish what we want to accomplish, we also realized that the Europeans and the whites in America, Americans are not very adventuresome. And so in whites, because they live in a dominant culture here in the U.S., they just don't want to go no place where they feel like they're a minority. And going into Africa, they feel like a minority in deep dark. Well, I don't like to call it the deep dark Africa. In sub-Saharan Africa, they feel they're going to be a minority. And being a minority, as we know in the United States, is very uncomfortable. We deal with it every day we walk outside the house. Okay, so the thing was, now, in order to develop Africa, it's going to take almost an army of African-Americans that's in the diaspora to go to Africa, taking their technology and their skills into Africa and sharing those skills and technology. Africa is a whole different culture. It's a whole different mindset. It's nothing like the American mindset, especially the American business mindset. So our thing was, so how do we get African-Americans to Africa? So we looked at, okay, they don't have any money. They don't own any airlines. The chances of them going is slim to none. Then we came up with, okay, so African-Americans work in the American corporations. And some of us are in executive positions, some of us are in management positions, and some of us are just ordinary employees. Now, those companies that we work in, their products are created from minerals from Africa. 40% of everything in the world, pretty much, gets its minerals from Africa. Like they used to say, such and such was the bed brat that Nebraska is the bread basket of America. Africa is the bread basket of wealth. Okay, there is no wealth without Africa. Largest continent, it's got 60% of all the world's natural resources. So those corporations that exist today that creates these CEOs that's making millions of dollars salaries each year, those minerals are coming from Africa. So we felt that if these employees in these American corporations could convince their upper-level managers and get as far as up to their CEOs, which we also contact CEOs of Fortune 1000 companies, and put pressure on them to expand their businesses into Africa, which means they're going to expand the footprint. They're going to expand their business footprint into Africa. And as they when they make that expansion, they're going to use African-American employees. Now, the corporations pick up the expenses of the trips. So now African-Americans can go to Africa on the corporation's dime. And they're also going to expand the corporation's footprint. And then while they're there, they can also locate potential wealth opportunities where they can start their own individual businesses and then become acclimated to the culture and become part of the community, and which in turn means that they're hiring more local citizens of the nations and helping to build a middle class, as well as building wealth in the African-American community here in the United States. So basically, it's a win-win situation all the way around. The corporations are winning because they're expanding. So corporations are actually making, $500 billion a year in their sales. They expand into the African continent. You got 1.4 billion people. The market there, a young market, between 75% between the ages of 17 and 35 years old. Which is it means that they're a consumer of market. So the corporations that has annual sales over $500 billion just here in the US now has the potential to increase that $500 billion to a million by expanding their footprint into Africa. They're gonna bring in more employees, African-American employees, because that's gonna be their base, initial base for going into Africa, implementing the expansion of their businesses. And the African people, it's going to gain wealth opportunities because they're going to have to partner up. You can't just take a business into Africa without partnering up with an African, like we concentrate on Sierra Leone. So if you go to Sierra Leone as IBM, IBM has to find a Sierra Leonean business partner, where IBM takes 35% ownership of a company and the Sierra Leone business person takes 35%. So now you create wealth in Sierra Leone, and as well as bringing in new employees. And another good thing about it is because the schools and the education base there is not up to our standards. So it's gonna be better for that corporation to bring in African-American employees who actually can create their product and teach their business while they're there in Sierra Leone, as they educate the Sierra Leone.
What are the first steps for somebody who is in that, you know, position to tell the president of the company? And I'm taking this from personal experience. When I work with Synology in Bellevue, and I am the only PR guy, you know, in the whole, you know, marketing, whatever department, and saying, hey, president, I see that we have people signed up who are platinum certified in Africa. I can help expand that because I have connections. What should somebody in that position right now tell their president of the company? Because I was told we're not ready to move into Africa. And this was a Taiwanese company. And we know they do business a little different, but so do the US. And people are sometimes intimidated because you could pretty much write your own ticket if you're the only one who's knowledgeable about something going to Africa. So what would be the steps to have that person pitch it to their, you know, president of the company, owner of the company?
Well, CEOs, upper level management, they only understand dollars and cents, okay, and shareholder obligations. So what you want to do first is you're going to look at the products that your company provides, and then you're going to look at how it's almost like doing a feasibility study. You're gonna look at the country you're trying to go into, and you're gonna want to see what's their GDP, how much disposable income the average person has, how much that they can actually afford to buy the product that your company has. And then when you write all of that up and you present it in a memorandum, you can go through your next level supervisor. And then if you don't get no feedback from that, then I would go above that person. And then I would go all the way to you get to the top. Another way is to go through human resources. Another way is when you are out on lunches with your friends, African-American friends, and you convince them that you collectively come together. Because every corporation today has what's called social responsibility. Most of them, the social responsibility policy is attuned to development in the U.S., helping the food banks and United Way support. And each of, like, if you work in a Fortune 1000 corporation, they have what's called charitable giving, okay? And then the person who's in charge of charitable giving are the ones who select where the funding is going to go. So each corporation has slated. And they have a person, they have their diversity manager who works with human resources and also works with charitable giving. So that diversity manager helps charitable giving to decide how they're going to fund some minority organizations. Like in Seattle, there's an organization called the, and here in Georgia too, where I'm at today, there is an organization called the Minority Supplier Development Council. So the Minority Supplier Development Council works with the SBA. I'm gonna speak real slowly on this in case people are taking notes. So they work with the SBA, the Small Business Administration. So the largest corporations in a city, be it Seattle, Houston, St. Louis, Chicago, the large corporations become memberships with the Minority Supplier Development Council. The Minority Supplier Development Council is working with the Small Business Administration. So those corporations, like here in Atlanta, you have Delta. So Delta would take almost $200 million a year, and that money is slated for minority companies. A lot of the banks, the average bank in the U.S., Chase Bank, Bank of America, in each of the large cities, they have about $200 million a year that they spend with minority companies. Okay, and that's just that's not part of charitable giving. That's part of the diversity spending, they call it. Okay, and so if they have that just for diversity spending, you can imagine they probably have three times that for development, spending for development. So you have to work with your human resources department, you have to work with your charitable giving department, and you have to work with your diversity department. And if you can get most African-American employees together, and then you send memorandums upline to the upline supervisor, and it has just have to make business sense. No corporations are gonna go over and put half a billion dollars into a country just because they wanna help black countries. They're only gonna do it because it's gonna make the corporation money. It's one thing about business. A business will buy anything, they don't care what color you are. If you're selling them something, but it has to make them money or save them money. And if you can do either of those two things, you will get the contract. Of course, you got to deliver it. But that's what upper level management understands. You either go, what you got, how is it going to make me money? How is it going to save me money? Well, I have a 1.4 billion market in Africa that has disposable income, 20% disposable income. They can purchase our product. And right now we have annual sales of $500 million a year. If we expand into Africa, we're gonna increase our company sales up to $1 billion. So that CEO is gonna look at that because it makes good business sense. He's gonna look at it and try to pick holes in it to see why it won't work. And every time you come back to you saying why it won't work, you got to explain to him why it will work. So what we do at Institute of Sustainable, Progressive Sustainable Development, we actually perform those studies and we actually prove, and then we even work with the banks to prove that those feasibility studies will work. It's hard for a CEO to tell us it is not possible to do it because it's just proven with numbers.
Wow. So, you know, and when you talk about the minority council, folks, you know, we've talked about this on the show. You got to know these organizations, PTAC, SCORE, SBA. You have to know them. These are free things. Minority council actually costs you a little bit of money and a little homework. But if you're doing business, it's not even $500. I know in Seattle, I think it was around two something. What, with all that you do, and you've given the reason, I ask all my guests, like, what is their community give back that they are doing or that they want to do in the future? And it seems like this whole project is that. So I need you to like dig deep and say something that's just out of this world that you want to do or something you haven't told us already, because I want people to know, since it's not about the money, what it is about, but how your mind works, and that everybody successful is giving back, you know, in some way.
Well, the way I give back is, you know, I mentor a lot of business owners and I do it for free. I don't charge for it. And the only thing I ask my pay is that they tell somebody else that looks like them. What I give and I show you, I want you to tell to someone else who doesn't know what I just gave you. Like I teach people how banks work. I teach people how to get a line of credit from a bank. I tell you how to start out with $10,000, and in 3 years, your business is going to be worth $1 million. I teach you how to, if you got $100,000, then how you can actually get $300,000 from the bank. Right? Those are secrets that white people have been doing for years. And we don't know about it. No one at the breakfast table ever told us about it. No one at the dinner table told us about it. But, you know, they've been doing business for 3,000 years and they have business principles that they've been implementing for years. And when I was at Dartmouth, we were taught those 3,000-year-old principles that every white person knows. Well, I won't say every, I'm speaking generalities. Most white people know that's in business and those that's not in business. And those are things that they do. And they're not even conscious of even doing it. But they do it because that's just how throughout centuries and decades, that's what they, it's just been passed down to them. You know, like a lot of people shop on, just to keep it simple, like a lot of people, you know, you go buy a used car on a used car lot. You know, the car costs $5,000. The sticker price is $5,000. Okay. Every white person goes on that car lot knows that is not what they want for their car. Every white person knows when they go to buy that car, they only want between $4,000 and $5,000 for their car. But if you give them $5,000, they're going to take it. But they do not expect you to come up there and say, I like this car. How much is it? $5,000. Then you write them a check. Right? They shocked at that. They don't expect that. That's not their culture. But see, we don't know that. We go in there, we just know that, you know, it's $5,000. Right? The white man said it's $5,000, so it's $5,000. That's what I got to pay for. So we don't know what the business, that European culture, it does not mean $5,000. You buy something on eBay, you buy something on Craigslist, white person selling it, that is not the price they want for it. you know, is always less than that. Always maybe we don't know it because we never were part. We've been on the margins, on the fringes of the society. We just never knew how the economics work in the white community. But we deal in the white community daily. We just not privy to the rules of it. We're on the outside. So those are things and secrets that, you know, it's like when you go buy a house and, you know, a lot of Black folks, we walk in the house and, oh, it's really nice in here. It's, you know, it's really good. Yeah. Oh, I love the carpet. I love the cabinets. I love, you know, and they told us at Dartmouth, that's not what white people do when they buy a house. They go in and if they love the house, they always find something wrong in the house. Even if there's nothing wrong in the house, you say something wrong with the carpet, something wrong with the cabinet. You never say it's nice, because if it's nice and I'm asking for $300,000, that means you got to give me $300,000 because you said it was nice. You didn't tell me nothing was wrong with it. You say, oh, this is nice, right? But they don't do that. You know, they go in and they find, you know, it's like, oh, I need to put a new roof on. You know, I got to paint this room. It's white and it's got to be green, right? And what they're doing is called it's called strategies of negotiation. So now, once I realize that I see the house, I like the house, it's priced right, okay? But I know the price that they asking for is not the price they want, okay? But I can't just say, no, I'm just going to give you $250,000 for the house. I got to have reasons for it. So I'm going to say, I got to put in new cabinets. It's going to cost me, I want some really nice cabinets. It's going to cost me $14,000. I want to change that carpet in there. And that's a really nice carpet, but I swear the color just won't go with my decor and my furniture. So I'm going to have to put a new carpet in there. And that carpet's going to cost me another $14,000, $15,000. So you come up with all of these things, the reasons why the price needs to be lower than it is. And that's what's happening in the white world every day, but not in our world. We go in and we just take total advantage.
So let me push back, because you're one of the few people that you'll understand this, and you have that world experience. The way you're saying, you know, white people buy things. When you go to Africa, you see the same thing. When people are even trying to buy underwear or food, and they'll say they don't want to pay the price advertised, right? And negotiation and haggling is part of their culture. So is it a white Black thing, or is it a cultural thing, how we are as Americans used to buying inside of our, you know, our culture? Because when you go to Cameroon, you know, I know my wife has a problem with everything, and her mom has a problem with everything, and her father has a problem with everything they see, because they wanted at half the price that it was offered at.
Well, that's haggling. That's more tourism. That's more tourism, because I go with you in you're in what you call the tourist trap, okay? And every tourist already know the tourist
trap. No, we're not tourists. We're not tourists in Cameroon. No, we're not tourists in Cameroon. They're from there.
Okay, but that's the tourist mentality, when you go to the market. When you go to the market in Africa, that's like being in Pike Place Market in Seattle, in a tourist trap, pretty much. Okay, but it's the market. It's the market, and so it's understandable that there is no set price. There's no market price. The market price is the price that you're willing to pay. And so you're able to negotiate and haggle those prices. But what I'm talking about is like a societal rule about the art of negotiation in the Western world. Okay, not like you're just haggling for prices. It's just that it's a rule that if you want to sell something and you're white, you just automatically ask for more money than it's worth. It's just what you do. You know, this is normal. Where in our world is different, you know. If I want $25 for these pair of pants, that's what I want. I don't think about I'm going to ask for $35, but I really only want $25. We don't think like that. They do. You know, that's what I'm saying. They do. So, yeah, like if you go into Africa, we're talking about going in there business-wise, okay, you're not going to set that price like a white person would set that price, you know. He's going to say, I want it at this amount, but I might get this amount. He's not going to do that. We're going to say, okay, well, the computer cost me $250. I want to sell it for $300. Okay, we just have a markup. Our markups is not even for wholesale. Then it goes to resale. Okay, the producer, the producer's price from the producer to the wholesale is marked up 50%. From the producer to the retail is marked up 50%. Okay, that's standard business, okay? We don't do that, right? We don't do that. So if I decide I want to go on a wholesaling, I already know when I buy from the producer, it's going to cost me 50% more. I mean, I'm going to sell it at 50% more, okay? Like, for instance, nowadays they have the marijuana things and people are growing marijuana. So the guy who grows the marijuana, he sells a pound of marijuana. I don't know what it costs. It just say $1,000. It sells it for $1,000. If I buy from him and I'm going to go in marijuana retail, I give him $1,000 for it, I know I'm automatically selling it at $500. It's just dialed in. It's just automatic stuff that we do in the business, you know. But as blacks, we don't do that. We buy for $1,000 and we say, okay, if I might make $1,200 off of it, or I might not put as much, you know, if I sell a eighth of a gram or whatever, you know, I'm going to sell it a little more, sell a little less in my community, a little more in the white community. So they're not written policies, but it's just how we think, because we just try to pay the rent. We just want to pay the rent and the bills. You know, we're not business minded, structured. We're just trying to pay the bills. We want to buy something, sell it, and make a profit. There's no rhyme or reason what the profit should be. We just buy it. I was talking to a guy the other day. He was in Sierra Leone. He was an American citizen, went to Sierra Leone, and we had a deal for fish. I think we may have talked about that. And I'm more corporate. I think corporate. So he had to just go find the price of the fish. It was 26,000 pounds of fish. He just needed to find what was the selling price of that. And then from there, we would draw up the contract. And he would not go get it because he said he needed to be paid because he had to get a taxi. He had to get a taxi, and he had to do this, and he had to do that. And I got to be paid before I do it. And so I'm corporate, so I'm like, I'm just asking you to find something. It's automatic to me that whatever you find, if it's $10,000, you're going to put a 3% finder's fee on it, 3% to 5% finder's fee. I'm just automatically thinking the guy knows this, but he didn't know it. He felt that he needed to be paid off the top. And so he didn't get the deal. So we ended up having to give the deal to a Lebanese person in Sierra Leone. And that's the thing that you run into, you know, you want to help, but then people won't allow you to educate them. So, but you need to deliver a product because you got a client, or got a customer waiting. So you got to go get it where you got to go get it to. And it was worth $78,000, but I didn't want to sell it to let a Lebanese person make the sale, but I had a client that's waiting, and he's going to do that every month. So I had to deliver it. Now we can go back and work on this Leonean and teach him how it works, you know?
Yeah. No, it's very interesting how business, every place you go, it can be done different, and why oversharing information of this is how we do business. And if you do business like we do business, we can do business. Is what I always like to tell people. I could give so much. I mean, I'm going to let my audience know, you're going to see this gentleman, if he's so willing, on other channels even bigger than this, and they're going to take it to different conversations. I like to kind of nerd out, get certain, you know, inside the mind, but I also don't want to give them too much because a good storyteller always knows you can leave them with the cliffhanger. And I want to be able to talk to you off air. So I thank you for coming on and giving this part of the game. We can always do this because you have stories on top of stories. Let me know, though, are there any books out there they can find you on Amazon that they can purchase that you've written?
No, because I don't do things for money. I meet my just a regular common guy and I see somebody struggling with something, then I offer them advice and I will just give them a few hours of my time. And that's, you know, that's what I do best. That's what I enjoy. And so I don't write books to make money. I don't charge people for money. I do legal work for free, but everybody don't call me with your divorce. But I do legal stuff, you know, because things are really, really simple. And like to start a business and get legalized and stuff, it's like, people pay like $1,500 for that. And I'm like, gosh, all you got to do is go online, look here, look there, get the form, download it, fill it in. If you can read, go pay $250 at the city and you license to go for business. You incorporate, you know. And I explain what an LLC means and what S corp means, C corp means, and those things. You don't need to pay an attorney for that. That's ridiculous, but people do it. So, but I would feel bad doing that because it's so small. It's a small thing for to do, and they charge people so much money for it. It's like I say, I couldn't sleep at night. You know, I just it's like it's simple. It's real simple. But the thing about the reason why it's not simple to most people is because you've never been introduced to it. And the one who has information is king. And so if you don't have information, you are ignorant to certain things, but most legal stuff is really, really simple. You know, I was teaching, I just want to say this because I think I need to say it. I was working with a girl who was having issues of getting child support. No, but the dad was trying to take the child because the mom didn't have any money and she didn't have no money for an attorney. He was wealthy, working in one of the big major corporations. And so he had all the power and all the money. So he had these hotshot lawyers and she didn't have a lawyer and she had to go to court and she didn't know what to do. So she knew she was going to lose. And I tried to explain to her, right, a petition. If you have the lawyer said, oh, we got to write a petition to the court, right? So those are just lawyer words. But when you break it all down, you just need to write a letter to the judge. And I told her, I said, just sit down and write a letter to the judge. Your Honor, blah, 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 blah. And this is what's happening in my life. This is what's happening in my life. And this is why I think that he should have the kid and I have the kid. And she won the case, you know? Just because things are simple, but there are secrets. There are secrets that's held, especially in medicine, and we'll get into that one day, medicine and law that keeps the poor man down because they use words that don't make sense to anyone, you know? I got to write a summons and complaint, okay? We got to do a service. Why don't you give me $700 because I got to serve somebody. And those are words that the common person don't understand, but when you break it down, it's real simple. And then people's like, you know, once you break it down, it's real simple. They're like, oh gosh, I didn't know that. You know, so we were going to do a TV series about where we was going to have a doctor main character and an attorney main character. And then they were running these everyday situations with people who didn't have any of this knowledge. And they would be almost like the Incredible Hulk. I don't know if you ever saw that, but they was going to be running from town to town, being chased by somebody. They get in these situations where someone was having an issue, and then they would help them, you know, by just teaching them the basics of getting through the, you know, getting rid of all the legal needs and the medical needs, and just getting down to what you're really talking about. You just need to write a letter to the judge. You know, and the judge got to answer it. You know, he got to answer it. It's his job to answer it. But people don't know that. So, yeah.
Well, the audience, you have got the game. We're going to take this off air. You guys have been blessed. Make sure you like, share, subscribe, tune in. The links will be in the description box, whether you are listening or you are watching this. And we thank you for sharing it, because somebody needs to be inspired with all the craziness that's going on in this world today. Y'all be blessed.
Hi everyone. Have you ever been curious about visiting Africa? Which African country were you interested in? Kenya, Nigeria, Uganda, South Africa, Ethiopia? Which country are you interested in? My good friend, Kellen Cash Coleman, came up with a course called My First Trip to Africa that'll guide you through this process. It's only $20, and in this course you'll learn about passports, visas, vaccinations that you need before you go there, as well as a budget, how much the trip is going to cost. He also talks about what you should pack, what you should take with you, how you should travel on a budget. Did you know that $100 is worth 1,000 South African rand and over 10,000 Kenyan shillings? So imagine what you can do with $100 back home. I say back home because I'm from Sudan, I'm African, I already know how it's like. I know that, you know, when you convert Canadian and American money, it goes a long way when you're traveling across Africa. So if you're curious, if Africa is a place that you've always wanted to go, always wanted to move there, Kellen Cash is the person to ask. Check out the course, there's a little preview you can listen to before you actually purchase it. If you're interested in this course, visit www.diversifiedgame.com. Don't miss out.